Oh, yep. Go for it.
All right, and now we should be live.
Hello.
Oh,
Hi,
hello, Arvanaut
y'all. Hello.
community. Greetings. It is
Salutations.
Wednesday, July 1st, 2020. 2020 is half over. Can you believe that?
No, I cannot.
And in 3 days, it is Independence Day in the US, and it's going to be first time digital.
All right, and so tonight we have some community D&D Dragon of Icespire Peak for you tonight. This is the Shadow Crew. Of course, be sure to check out all of Arv's stuff, which Echo will put in the chat.
Oh, that I did?
Yeah,
Aha.
the Arv things, the Arv shop. Make sure to check out all of those. Check out us via the Shadow Crew command. Make sure to support the Black Lives Matter movement. Bang BLM. Yep, thank you, Echo. And other than that, how
There
about.
is.
Yes?
If you want to watch more of our campaign, you can just go
Ah.
on to Arvin's Elrond YouTube channel at
Yes.
ArvTube.
Go to Arv's YouTube to catch up on all of the.
Importante.
All of our previous adventures. Of course, I am shadowed mage, not very shadowed tonight in the bright light, but
He says that, but don't believe him.
so tonight, in our adventures, after last time having dealt with a mine full of were-rats and one of the members of the party having been afflicted by the lycanthropic curse. The party this time will be off in pursuit of what they a cure that they found that was written on a piece of paper that had been on the leader of the were-rats. We're gonna go see if it holds any water, so to speak. Of course, right below me in the webcam arrangement there is Rockgod. Rockgod, do you want to introduce yourself and say who you're playing tonight?
Oh, I am Rock God. Tonight I am playing Malik Hallimorodin, the elf ranger, wood elf ranger, who is inflicted by said lycanthropic were-rat nonsense. And I am excited to start out on this totally unprepared for side quest because of one shitty roll.
All right, thank you, Rock God. We'll see if my side quest is any good. Of course, right below Rock God is a hoodie from No Quarter TV. Go
No
ahead.
quarter underscore TV.
Yeah, that's
Yeah,
very
sorry.
important.
Underscore TV, yes. Yeah, how about you introduce yourself and who your character is?
I'm Hoodie. I'm playing Esil Moldleaf. Oh God, every time. A Celestial Pact of the Tome Warlock.
Asimar,
An Asmar
celestial patron,
Celestial
pact of.
Patron, Pact of the Tome
There you
Warlock.
go.
Okay, just gotta. There's so many qualifiers. I'm playing a warlock.
And soon to become a Medusa because it has a robust snake, so it has 5 out of 7 snakes. That goddamn evolution is.
I think I'm the only
Everything.
one of the party fully decked out in magic gear at this point. I have full 3 attunements going on. I
And you're a
am,
warlock, so that's even
yeah,
worse.
I'm loving it right now. I am playing a very eccentric, moody, but mostly
Oh.
bookwormy person who's just obsessed with reading. That's pretty much Esil in a nutshell. He is mildly worried about the things going on, but mostly concerned about what's going to happen on the next page. So yeah, with that, I'll pass that on down.
And below a
Yeah,
hoodie
thanks, Warlock.
is of course Echo Alpha underscore X5. I think I got
Yeah,
that
now you
right.
remember down the score. Well, good on the ears, that boy. But yeah, salutations and good evening from Norway. Hello, yes. I will be playing Jakunas, the Drow Elf Rogue Assassin, who somewhat has been just killing, enduring, and now has perhaps may have lost another friend who might become a were-rat, which is very I don't know. It is odd, to say the least.
Mm-hmm.
But beyond that, I would say life is good. I'm expecting some giveaway rewards because I'm expecting from Jennifer Brozak from the giveaway at ArvCon and so forth and so forth. So I'm looking forward to that. And yeah, I would say the shadows are in the drift. Shadow, pass it up to you, boy. Guide us, almighty one.
All right. And of course, there will be a bit of a surprise tonight, I think. For some people might already be in the know, but I am sure we will.
Okay, I will spoil it for you. Everybody, Malik will become a were-rat.
Oh, he already is.
No, but Shakunis and Isil are in solidarity also going to become were-rats. That's the real surprise. Yeah, no, please, no, Shadow. No, I beg of you.
Well, we might just have to see what happens with what happens tonight. So. Let's jump.
Here we
right.
go. New campaign. We're all were rats. We have no equipment, but we all have a deck of many things.
Oh man, that would be chaos.
I'm gonna pull 7 cards immediately. Let's kick it off. Feeling lucky.
I'll be down for that, actually.
All right.
Were rats.
So let's see if I can get this going here.
Animatoons.
So we were just kind of. We had gotten the poison from the tail of that whatever it was last time, and then we were just kind of arguing about what to do next. I think.
Yeah,
I think
yeah,
we I believe have so. Everything what we need except for, like, average spices and herbs and stuff that we can pick up anywhere.
Yes, so the torn out page of the book of the alchemist's ramblings about a possible cure for the curse of lycanthropy, even though outside of, you know what, I'm just not going to get into it. I have etymological qualms with using the word lycanthropy for all the various different forms, but whatever, I'm just gonna go get by it. I'm not going to dwell on it. Word geek. Anyway, possible cure for lycanthropy, and it had said that you need the saliva of the lycanthrope who bit you and afflicted you with the curse. You needed the poison from the tentacles of a carrion crawler, and then there was a listing of various other herbs and leaves and whatnot that then make up the rest of the ingredients for a potion. Now, of course, none of you three, Malik might have a little bit of knowledge about some brewing of potions, but not to the level of care required for this particular potion. So you do have the two, like, most important ingredients, but you do need to get the rest of them and find an alchemist who can brew this potion. And so then at the end of last time, you guys had come into this particular room after fighting the carrion crawler. You had found kind of like it looked like it was maybe the mining operations head office had a desk in it that had been kind of looked like it had been rummaged through. There had been a chest that you found with a false bottom that had a scroll of protection from beasts underneath it, I believe. And so I will let you guys jump off from there.
Well, so I'm sorry, please go.
I'd say we go back and We have now the what was it, the saliva from the Vera that flitted you, did we not, Malik?
Yeah, we do.
I'd say we, I don't know, what did the notes say that we need to gather again?
Well, there was the saliva, and then there was the poison from the thing, and then just a few different, I believe it was 11 herbs and spices that we needed.
And you just pour them into one another, right? That's how, I've never, so do you grind them, or?
I'm not really sure of. I think we're gonna need an alchemist for that.
Well, there was the midwife, of course, who owes us a great life debt, clearly. And I mean, if worse comes to worse, we once again can just pour them into various cups and you can drink wet herbs. I don't know. It sounds great.
I think maybe our best bet, even though it's further than just going back to Phandalin, is to go ask Adabra Gwyn. Because she seems like an accomplished alchemist. Although, I wouldn't know. Shakunis, you were in her house. You did go into her house. Did it seem like she knew what she was doing?
It would seem that she knew what she was doing. I mean... None of us have ever tested the healing force that we gained from the dealing with the Manticore. But she seemed an accomplished alchemist. I suggest we visit her. And she was not far from town either, so we could venture back to Phandalin and see if we could acquire these herbs there.
So we get to leave these caves? You guys are talking about exploring them. I'm so excited. Can we go now? I hate it here.
Isn't you hate it everywhere when it's a cave?
Well, it's also very hard to read in here. I'm not sure if you've noticed all of this dim light around, but I just don't want to be in this anymore. I hate it here.
It's actually well lit. There's torches everywhere.
Oh, all right. I'll still say it's dim light. I'll stand true.
That's fine. Yeah. Just wanted to clarify.
I mean, if you wanted to look around, I think we do have some time.
No, I'm good. We can leave, please.
Right, I'm not gonna argue with that.
No, I agree. We must return to Phandalin, but after the loss of our dear departed friend here, I should just make haste, and perhaps we can acquire some. What was the alchemist's name again? It was
Adabra Gwyn.
Adabra Gwyn, yes. We could perhaps buy the house from her.
Yeah, I think that would be our best bet. I think we should go right past Phandalin and not even stop there. I don't think there's any alchemists. I mean, maybe I'm wrong, but...
Well, we can always check. You don't know that. There could be someone in town that's new, or... I don't know. Maybe we just didn't talk to everyone. I didn't talk to anyone there. I think most of them were actually dirty peasant people, so... You never know.
And well beyond that, we have our Sir Raskin. He could always just look after things here, because it seems that all the verrats have been taken care of.
I think the whole point of him being here was for him to look after things here.
That's correct.
So we can just go then. Do we have to talk to them? Do they owe us things? They owe us money, don't they? Did they already give us the money? I've lost count. Let's ask them again for money. I'll immediately leave the room.
Okay.
Isel, you will ask for the money, for the gold coins.
Oh, I'm on it. I'll just walk straight to where I remember seeing them last.
Okay. So, will you move your... token in roll 20 then?
Yes.
All right.
There we go.
So Isil's leading the way,
I
guess.
Oh, God. I double clicked everything. What a mistake I've made. Down, because I'm going the exact way that I had gotten here.
Okay.
So as to not run into anything new.
All right. So, Don John Raskin has still just kind of been... it looks like everyone has kind of just like been like standing up or leaning against the walls of the tunnels and has almost just been like taking a nap. And as you guys walk in, then Don John kind of like opens, like his eyes snap open, and he sees you walking up, and he's like, "Ah, thought maybe you guys had left already. I was concerned that maybe you weren't gonna be able to get my signed papers to deliver back to the townmaster in order to get your payment for delivering me here."
I will walk up, just hold up my hand. So that's how I get the money, then? I just deliver papers for you? Okay, please, put it here.
and then Don John actually, like, just kind of, like, eyes you up and he says, like, "Actually, do you have a piece of paper I could borrow?"
"Oh, I have lots." And I'll just start, like, pulling out parchment from my pack.
And a writing utensil.
I also have one of those. I'm just, like, pulling everything out.
If you'd be so kind.
A nice little candle that goes along with it. It's a whole writing set.
And so then he
just crosses his arm and just shakes his head. It's like,
he takes all of this from you and then he kind of like, with a flourish, he writes some lines on this piece of paper that basically state like, "I, Don John Raskin, have been delivered safely to the Mountain's Toe gold mine by this party of adventurers," and then like he leaves like spots for like your names and then like signs his name at the bottom and hands it back to you.
I'll just start writing my name in like extremely elegant cursive, and then under Malik's name I'll just look at him and write an X. "I got you, buddy." I'll hand it over to Shakunis to sign.
Then the signs I pass on back to Issel.
I'll roll it up and just stick it right back in my bag. Or I guess I probably have some type of weird parchment belt holder thing where the scroll of protection from beasts is.
All right. And so then Don John says, "All right, so are you guys are off then? Things seem to be all right here now that the were rats have been driven out. I'll see if I can maybe get things back up and running with the few miners remaining here." He nods across to the still napping dwarves.
Before we leave, you might... we ran into... you might have some carrying crawlers. All right, well, we're gonna go now. we're gonna take the horses outside. All right, bye, Don John.
And he just kind of like watches you leave and then he just shrugs. All right.
Not too bright of an easy. No.
All right, so you guys are leaving. I will bring you across over to the world, or well, the overall map. Where's the overall map? Yeah. Too many things. Wrong thing.
I will, of course, get on my horse backwards, because I'm very bad at riding horses. And just hope to follow anyone else.
All right, so you guys should actually be more so up by Mountains to a Gold Mine. I will just move you if that's okay. All right, now I have to do a Dungeon Master thing. Okay.
Ladies and gents, this is transition in RP style.
All right. So you guys head back out towards Phandalin, since that is kind of along the way towards Umbridge Hill, where Adabra Gwyn is.
Oh, right.
During the ride, about every 15 minutes, I'm going to check in on Malik.
Okay.
How are you feeling? Any better? Worse?
Yeah. Oh, I'm about the same.
And actually, Malik, give me a Constitution saving throw.
Oh, no.
Ooh. Or wait, would that be Constitution? No, that should be a Wisdom saving throw. Wisdom saving throw. It's willpower.
Oh, those I'm pretty good at.
And it is the 1st of July, so inspiration should have been reset, but it hasn't been yet, I believe. At least on mine, so.
How's a 13 do?
A 13 is just good enough for my DC of 13.
Oh my god. You are just barely coming through this.
So you do feel kind of like this, like, overwhelming urge deep within you to just kind of like embrace the your new bestial nature. This is yearning to get out, but you're able to kind of like quell it down, and it doesn't quite seem to take over yet. But you can tell that maybe if you don't do something within the next 2 days, that you might start to find it very difficult to try and deal with the curse.
Iso, you ever had venison?
Maybe. I don't. Is it a meat?
Or yes,
is it
like a, it's okay. Deer.
I mean, I've eaten in the inns around here, so I'm assuming yes.
Probably, yeah, yeah. I like venison. Some reason I like it like medium, but I think I might try like a little bit more rare. I'm getting the feeling like I want to try maybe a rare venison.
I look at Shakunas. See, that's a problem. That can't be. This is not. I mean, I was hoping it was just going to be a pretty, you know, very easy to wear. Rat doesn't seem very threatening. I have pocket cheese for this occasion, but I don't. Meat is a little bit more of a dangerous territory, I guess.
Oh, no. It has nothing to do with any of that. I'm just thinking out loud.
Oh, okay. Well, I guess we should just hurry. Hopefully you won't need to kill anything and eat it on the way.
Well, not yet. I mean, I did promise Shakunas that the next time we were out, I'd catch him a deer and cook it up for him.
With your, like, teeth and claws, or...?
No. My bow.
Hmm. Right. Crack open my book again.
All right, and the rest of your journey back into Phandalin is uneventful until you actually enter Phandalin, which, of course, now I will bring you over to that map.
Which is a dreary town, and everyone should just die and rot in hell. And he's a townsman.
Where'd it go? Oh, there it is. Guys are coming in from the north. So actually your icons are still, tokens are still there. You should be a little bit more like up there-ish. Or whoever's leading the way. But you can see that there is a commotion in kind of the center of town. There's a bunch of people gathered, and you think you can hear the faint sounds of an instrument and singing coming from that direction.
Hello. What's that noise? Is that like there is something going on there?
Yeah. Let's go get our money.
I'm deep in a book. Just wave a hand. Mm, yeah, whatever.
Iso, money.
Oh, yes, right. Of course. I just immediately hold up the thing while reading. All right, take me to it.
Okay. So as you guys, I assume then you're walking south down the path to get to the townmaster's hall. So you will have to pass by the commotion in the center of town.
I assume the commotion here is there.
Yeah. And so there are there's a small crowd gathered, maybe about 12 to 16 people gathered around a performer who is seems a bit of a strange sight to you, as it looks like an anthropomorphic leopard, just kind of dressed up in like performer gear, and is playing an instrument. And now we have a certain surprise.
Oh, this is Santa Claus, Daddy! Is this Santa Claus?
Okay, so I have to...
Sorry, babes, I had to.
Let's see if... And unmute. We have a new person! Welcome in, Trish E. Max.
Greetings.
Who will be the player of this
yes, peeps.
New character, the Tabaxi Bard, who is currently performing in the center of Phandalin, as our intrepid adventurers are walking by. Hold on. I think I need to actually hit the button. There we go. I had to hit a button.
Bear with us, peeps. Bear with us.
Yeah, there it is.
There she is.
Forgot this is in studio mode. Not so great at the streaming things.
We're still a fresh campaign after 9 episodes.
All right. Welcome in, Trish.
Thank you for inviting me.
Yeah, well, it's certainly a pleasure to have you. How about you tell us a bit about yourself and the character that you will be playing?
Okay. about me, I am on several podcasts. I'm the host of the Supergirl podcast on the Incomparable Network. I'm a member of the Skiffy and Fanty crew. I guess Arvin would want me to say the Hugo nominated Skiffy and Fancy crew. I've guested on the SFF audio podcast several times. I occasionally blog at whatsthewordnow.blogspot.com, and I'm on Twitter at PE Matson. My character is Grace of the Refreshing Breeze, a Tabaxi bard. She is a very curious and outgoing soul, but she doesn't make actual close friends easily, but she's outwardly gregarious.
What kind of instrument is she playing?
Right now she is playing her lute. She has a pack with other stuff. You can see some sort of pipe instrument poking out of it. She's also wearing a rapier and a rather fine cloak. She has silver earrings with pearls on them. Those are the main points, I believe.
A female Gesma Adima.
And so I'm singing some heroic ballad, but I'm pausing occasionally to share bits of news with the townsfolk about areas that I've been traveling through.
Okay. I think I updated our command correctly.
Yes.
All right. So, would Grace try to rope in these new people who are walking by?
Not particularly. She doesn't try to make people listen to her. She is confident enough of her abilities to just sing. And, you know, the right people, the good people will want to stop and listen, and the people who don't, so what?
All right.
She's not singing for money. She's just kind of passing the time and sharing some news.
Okay. So, Malik Isil Shakunis, how do you react to this sight?
Well, Shakunis is gonna... he's gonna just probably go, he's a very fine too. It's very... I don't know. It kind of strides, but... But then he turns towards Malik and just go, I desire to listen to this, but we are pressed for time for this curse cannot wait. But I don't know. Isil?
I'm not stopping walking. I just have the paper up.
Of course you're not stopping. This is awful.
The moment you even kind of gave any headway, I'm just like, I'm doing the book walk, you know, when you're just like so in it. And I have the paper up and I'm just walking straight, like until I run into something at this point.
People, this is how you have this is smartphone in the world of roleplay in 5th edition. The books are the smartphones.
Yeah. In one shot, I did get addicted to smartphones. So, yeah, no, yeah, that happened.
All right. So,
I see as these people are walking by are a scholarly fellow, someone who looks like a fighter or rogue, maybe. Mm-hmm. And what's the other person that I see?
That would be
a ranger.
The ranger.
A ranger. Yeah. Yes.
A drow elf rogue.
And a wood elf ranger.
Yeah, okay, as elves. I reach the end of my song, I call out, "What news, travelers?"
Mountain's toe mine is full of were-rats.
Oh my goodness.
Well, it was. It isn't anymore.
And Shakunas just nudges towards Isil and go, Isil, she's talking to you.
What is going on? Hello? Hi.
Greetings.
Hello. What's happening? I just look at Shakunas and Malik. Why did what's going on?
Why, I'm only asking for the news, as is my wont. I like to know what's going on in an area that I visit. I hear that you were just at a place full of were-rats that is no longer full of were-rats. Did your own actions have anything to do with that?
Oh, actually, I'm not a bragger, but I did kill the maximum amount there. That was me. That was all. I actually did something in that one. That was a fun time. What else is happening though? Ooh, that's a good question. There's a dragon. That's pretty that's the pertinent news right now, I think.
I have heard of the dragon.
The orcs and the manticores and I just start rambling. I have all of the knowledge, but I'm still kind of in the daze of reading. So I'm just rambling like all of the quests almost verbatim.
And in fact, Grace, you would have seen the dragon flying overhead just a few hours earlier, probably heading south. It looks like it had kind of flown in from the northeast and kind of came high up in the sky across the town, heading towards the south.
And these travelers were also coming from the north?
Yeah.
I hope you did not encounter the dragon.
Isil kind of stop and look down. Well, how about that? We might have. We seem to have lost a member of our party. And then I'll just open the book again and go back to reading and sit down.
I took it out as very heavy hearted because it was a fine. It was a sort of friend of us and all. Goes, we were inside the. Was it the dwarf place we were? He got hit by mimic, didn't he?
You were in Nomengard, and then when you were heading from Nomengard the dwarven excavation.
Now that was it.
When you were
assisting some gnomes, some paranoid gnomes, or we barely escaped with the lives, and the dragon come forth. We tried to attack. We tried to the slayer, but they caught us off our guard and took Vance from us, and we fear he having been lost to us.
Look, what my friend here is trying to say is, yes, we encountered the dragon, and he took our comrade, and we're gonna go take his head.
That is an ambitious plan, but perhaps a just one.
Well, we're not gonna go right now, I mean.
Ah. perhaps that is best. Well met, fellow travelers. Fare ye well. And I start playing something again.
Okay.
Iso. Mm? Money.
What? Yes, I'll call out. My friend's also cursed or something. And then I'll start kind of wandering around. Does anyone actually know an alchemist around in town? Hello?
And someone who's just nearby just kind of like looks over and says, have you been to Adabra's, Umbridge Hill, south of town?
Okay, no, you were right, Malik. All right, so where's the money at?
And actually, in rare occurrence, the door to the townmaster's hall, you can actually see, is open, and standing in the doorway is the townmaster. He's not actually, like, outside, but he's, like, standing there, like, watching the performance, like, from afar.
It's all right, baby steps. It's all good.
Yeah.
He's getting there.
Well, Shukuno's like notices of this, and he just go. Townmaster is out. The townsman is out of his. The door is open. What is this? What is this nonsense?
Seeing this stuff going on, I don't start singing. I just sort of noodle on my instrument while I watch what's going on.
Sure. Okay.
I hold the piece of paper like directly out in front of my body now, instead of over my head. And I just walk straight at him.
Okay.
I'm going to follow right behind.
And I'm making full eye contact with this man who I think hates me, but he owes me money now, so it's on.
He sees you approaching, and he kind of like takes a step back. He's like, oh, you're back already. How is it? Oh, I see you have a paper for me. Which
yes.
Which quest is this that you're claiming?
And then we helped. Like,
he reaches out and he takes the paper and then like he looks down at it and he's like, "Oh, Don John Raskin. Yes, yes, of course."
Yeah, something about toes.
Mountain's Toe Gold Mine. Yes, yes, of course.
That's the one.
So I see from this signed affidavit that you delivered him safely there. I suppose you wish then to be paid for your escorting services?
That is why my hand is out.
All right. Well, give me a moment and I'll retrieve your gold. And he like turns around and he runs back into his office at the back of the hall.
I'll look back at Malik and Shakunas. So do you guys want to try stealing a pencil again?
And Shakuna just gives, just crosses his arms, crosses his chest, just go at Isil.
No, it didn't work out very good last time. I don't want to push my luck.
I don't know, it worked out perfectly for me. I'll say, very full of myself.
Wise ass.
All right, and then shortly thereafter, he returned with four little satchels of coins, each containing 25 gold. And he tosses them to you, kind of like from a few feet away, and he says, "Here's your payment."
Issa will do some quick math of the people that are there versus how many bags of gold there are and just try to scoop them up as quickly as possible before he does any math. She says, "Thank you." And turn around and start handing them out.
Gunas just turns towards the bard and walks over and he goes, "So, how long have you been in the town, miss?"
I've been in the town for only a few hours. I'm just traveling around, getting to know the country a little bit. if you want to know my name, it is Grace of the Refreshing Breeze. Many of this area simply call me Grace.
Grace.
Yes, Grace is better.
I am Sukunas of the Underdark, and I'm bringing me the companion, the one with the book is Isil, and the man who seems a bit more for wear is Malak, the wood elf. Soon become were-rat, unless we find a cure for him.
Oh, how dire. I mean, there's nothing wrong with being furry, but having that state forced upon you, I imagine, would be very unpleasant.
That it is so. So, as of we just come from north from the mountain Gold Toll, and so far we have yet to begin to look for more of the ingredients that were necessary, some herbs and some other concoction. And he goes towards the part, and he looks towards Ethan and Malak and just go, "What of you? What is it that you do other than sing tales?"
Well, as it happens, I'm not just an entertainer. I'm a member of the College of Fahluchan, of the Bardic College of Lore. and I am currently in a journeying phase to gain more experience of the world. Collecting tales, but also if there comes a challenge that seems fitting for me to meet, I would certainly consider something along those lines.
And it just ponders for a moment and dwells and
I certainly have sympathy for your friend, but I am not a cleric. I have no power to remove curses or anything like that.
I do not believe a cleric's spell would remove this curse. It seems what is the common word for this? Complex in a way. But you say you seek adventure. Well, we have, since the loss of our comrade Vance, we have been at near death a few times.
I didn't say I sought adventure, but experience, but I suppose one comes with the other.
trust me, that it does. As I well have been near death as well. A number of times that had been not for Isil, of course. You may see an Asimar just reading a book, but trust me, when you encounter something and you fight alongside him, you will meet an entire different person.
Huh. He's interesting.
To say the least, he is an interesting character. The short time I have known him. And he just looks back towards Malik and says, well, they should be going. Well, if you wish to perhaps come along, well, we will be around town for some time, or perhaps upon the Umbridge Hill, which is, was that east or was it northeast?
Umbridge Hill is south.
Oh, pardon me.
That's okay.
Well, we are to, if we cannot seek some of the herbs here within the town, we will go towards south to visit my brain. Help me out. What was her name again?
Adabra.
Adabra Quinn.
Yeah.
I'm going to see the alchemist upon the mill. She was under some what was the English name? She was under some disturbance from a manticore.
Mm.
Sir, it is, you can, this town certainly has its charm in the form of various evilness that is afoot around.
Well, the people here are good folk, it seems, but none have offered any marvelous tales to me. If it suits your mood, I could walk along with you as you travel towards the alchemist, and perhaps you could tell me a little more about your adventures.
I will.
I pack up my stuff.
Okay.
Shakunis.
And then there's
Shakunis, we should get going.
I want to be berating the town master, the town hall guy, about where to get herbs.
Okay.
The entire time that their conversation is happening, Malik is just very silently watching me.
Yeah, I'm just watching him. Yeah.
Just like and really just trying to put the screws to a guy who probably just doesn't know any better.
And Harbin just keeps saying like, well, just go see Adabra. She can sort you out.
There's no one in town. You're telling me that no one in this great, vast town that you seem to have here of Dirty Hill people have any type of herbs or remedies or spices? It was spices, right, Malik? It was spices.
It was 11 herbs and spices, yeah.
11 of them.
Well, they're
special.
There may be someone in town who has some knowledge of this, but Adabra is the only one in the area. Like she would be the specialist, unless you.
So
were...
why wouldn't she live here in town? Why would you let her live out in the boonies? What type of town is this? We have no one else here.
The quest we sent you on in the first place was to bring her back to town, but you told us that she didn't want to. She wanted to stay out there.
Well, that's your failing as a townskeeper or whatever it is that you do here. You just let us waltz in and paid us to have her yell at us, to yell at you. I don't know. Seems all very weird. But I guess, sure, whatever. Have the only alchemist of the town live so far away that she can get attacked and die. Wow. Some town that you're running here, mister.
And while they're talking, the Ishikunas comes in and goes, I see the townsmen are giving us trouble again.
Is entertained by this conversation as I am, we should get going.
Yes, well, fine, whatever. You've been great, Herbert, or whoever you are. Goodbye. We'll be back, probably.
My name's Harbin, but so long. And then he slams the door.
I'll tell you
later, Herbert.
It was really nice to see you out of your house, actually. You should, I don't know, maybe step foot outside next time.
Get rid of the dragon, and then we'll see. He calls out from behind the now closed door.
So, Addie's? What was her name again? Adabra.
Adabra Quinn, yeah.
Adabra Quinn. Quinn.
Is Grace just behind Shakunis? Was she still packing up at this point?
I assume so.
It didn't take me long. All I really had out was my loot.
I'll look at Shakunas. Oh, you brought the song person. Well, are you coming with us to Adabra's?
At the moment, I wished to hear more about your adventures, and so I was going to. Your friend, Shakunas, kindly invited me to accompany you for the time being.
It's my thinking. I hope
that is suitable to you as well.
Well, I don't want to die, so more people is always a very, very, very good option.
How very flattering.
Thank you. I am quite a charmer. And I'll just open my book and start walking.
Oh, yeah. Quite a charmer, right?
If you're going to be coming with us, we should probably get you a horse then.
Well, it's not far.
Because we're all on horses.
Well, you were all on horses, yes.
We were.
We didn't take the horses back? I thought we hopped on the...
We took the horses to here, but I think we got off of them here, and then we've been walking the whole time.
Yeah, they are stabled by Barthen's provisions.
Oh, well, let's go back and get them.
I can tumble on a horse and tumble back off one. That sounds great.
I suppose the stable has an amount that I could rent.
Yes.
And so I do.
Oh, just whistle and go roach. The teleportation.
You'll find a horse on a roof of a house somewhere.
In a tree.
So,
crash course in horse riding. Crash at that tree.
When the... You follow the rest of them when they go back to get their horses. And there are a few other horses also in the stables.
What's the name of the guy that runs the stables? Do we know?
Stable boy?
Stable boy.
What else is there?
It's actually, this one on this edge of town is just run by one of Barthen's sons. He's probably, only about 18 or 20 years old, but like he just kind of like make sure that the horses are looked after.
You're one of Barthen's sons, right?
Aye, yes, sir.
How much is it to rent an extra horse?
Oh, I believe that like with the agreement that was made with whoever paid for it last time, it wasn't any of you. I think you can just have another horse for free.
What a pleasant and accommodating town this is. So I pick out the best looking spare horse.
Okay. It's a nice roan colored one.
I suspect they are most kind to us because they are very under suspicion they may die or the sudden death.
Alright, so then I assume you all get on your horses and then start to head out of town to head Shadowfax, to Umbridge Hill. Unless
I will
anyone...
ask for a leg up help from anybody to get on my horse.
I'll help.
Oh,
I'll
do we want to do this again?
No, I'm gonna flop on it and then squirm around and then just hold on to it tightly.
All right, everyone, make the animal handling checks.
Okay. There. I hope it. Hey, the first one though, not bad.
Ay ay ay.
All right. So everyone is able to successfully get up on their horses.
But of course,
Shakunas's horse kind of bristles a bit, having decided that it didn't have long enough to rest before being taken out again. But no, Shakunas does not accidentally assassinate his horse.
Not unless it was drunk, Arvin. Not unless it was drunk.
A trip fall, shock dagger to the heart.
Ooh. All right. Well.
Oh, no. Oh. I could just imagine now. Shakunas, one morning. It's going to go. This is a horse sleeping. Okay. Shock dagger. Clear. Horse will go. Kill.
You're lucky that this is considered an easy task, so it was only a DC 8.
Yeah, I'm lucky since you're the DM. I don't know what you got up your sleeve, but you got something up your sleeve.
Okay, so now I need to bring you back out to the world map.
I am going to take the lead and give the horse a hey-ya and take off. Like in a fast.
Hey-ya!
I thought it. I didn't say it, but I thought it. Right there with you.
Okay. And then I need to.
I'll be desperately trying to follow, but read at the same time. So I'll have like the book tucked in front of me and the reins like in the hands, just trying to do both, but failing at both also.
Bring you all down around here.
And Shakun's was telepathically moved by a deity named Shadow Deity.
Yes, I am actually the one above all, even above Ao.
You hear that, Arvan? He's calling you out. The Shadow Deity is calling you out.
I am the Demiurge. Alright. Yeah. That is Trish's token. I don't know if I can, let's see here, try and bring that up a little closer. It's a leopard with some music notes and an earring.
Ah!
Or if I, let me see here.
I suddenly get the black and whites feeling in me now.
No.
If Shakunas appears to be riding comfortably and in control, I will talk with him a little more about his adventures, which we don't need to play out. But if he's not, then I'll just watch everybody.
Okay. Oh, he is riding comfortably. So.
I think it's just Isil who will be a mess on the horse.
Okay.
Sprawled out, robes kind of askew. It'll be fine.
People, I keep saying it, and I keep meaning it. His soul is soul turning into Medusa. It's going to be Chimera, Medusa, Asimov, so let's throw something by the end of this campaign.
I already have enough qualifiers to my class. I don't need any more. I'm good.
You say that now. But I don't believe you.
So, Umbridge Hill, where Adabra is just it's supposed to be a few miles south of Phandalin, so it'll just kind of be maybe a couple hours at a leisurely pace on your horses. And to do another DM thing.
We count the horse ride as a short rest then?
Sure, you can. I mean, yeah. How that's beneficial to you at this point, I'm not entirely sure, but...
I'd cast spells before, and now I have all my spells back.
You guys had rested at the mine before you came here.
Well, we were... Oh. Well, now I have all my spells back. I don't know why it said that I still had to cast a spell.
Okay.
So I'm just trying to get that cleared.
Yep. Nope. Everyone should be, like, full health, full resources. Okay.
And we were getting the new class action at the level up, wasn't it? Were we?
Yes, at the next level up.
Okay, good.
Oh, well, this is interesting. As you're riding your horses south to Umbridge Hill, you see the dragon fly back over top, and it seems to then kind of circle around Phandalin for a while. And then it flies back off to the northeast.
What can I tell about the dragon? Is it large? Does it look old or, you know, a middle aged?
It is. It appears to be a young. Let me get the color right this time, because I got that wrong once before. It is a young white dragon. The general knowledge that has been spread throughout the region has been that it has been layering at Ice Spire, the ruins of Ice Spire Hold on Ice Spire Peak in the mountains that are to kind of like the northeast of Phandalin. In fact, actually, I should be able to... Where's my...
While Shadow Mage is doing some Dungeon Master stuff, I just want to remind everybody, welcome to day 9 of Community D&D with the Shadow Crew, and say hello again, welcome to our new edition, Treasure Mats, from the previous D&D with yours, I believe. What was it, the adventure? Do any of you remember?
Shadow... Mines of Phandalin, is that?
Ah, yes, we're playing a sort of campaign.
It was Arv's D&D with viewers, the
yes.
Lost Mines of Phandelver. Which is in this same region, though.
Notice the Phandalin that's right above Malik, the people. If you want to know more about us, you can just do exclamation mark Shadow Crew. If you want to know who our characters are, you can just do exclamation mark Shadow Cars. C-H-A-R-S. God damn it, your English language is such a complicated language. And I'm self-taught. Gee, cracky. And if you want to know more about the channel itself, you can just do exclamation mark our things or all things. And there's, of course, the shop, exclamation mark our shop. And let's not forget the most important thing these days, which is exclamation mark BLM. But again, Black Lives Matter, Human Lives Matter, Planet matters, so.
All right. Thank you, Echo. So, you should be able to see now I've actually put the indicator on the map for Icespire Peak. And the mountains there?
Must. Wow.
Yeah, right there.
Yep.
Just for anyone who's interested, I just dropped my character image icon of Grace into the Discord chat general, if anyone wants to look.
Nice.
At a close-up.
Must look now. Makes me think of the Russ award again. Russ something.
Rakshasa? Nothing to do with that.
Well, makes me think of there was a cat race that I saw on the Aurora tool set for the Never Meet the Knights.
Grace is a member of the Tabaxi.
I'm not sure what would have been in the Winter Knights.
They are actually a race of cat like creatures from a different continent from Theron.
Well, yeah. So
another continent on the Arboretorial planet, ladies and gentlemen.
Yeah. Well, technically, it's just Toril now again.
Oh, okay. Sorry.
Well, no. Like the continent that you guys are on is Faerun. The planet being Toril. The Tabaxi are from Maztica, which is on a continent that's in the, I believe it's the southern part, like kind of like, it would be considered south of like the Sword Coast, but it's like way off in the ocean to the west. Because it's all lots of jungle.
Oh, and as Grace travels with the group and gives close to Kunas, she could probably notice very slightly, a black rat that's resting upon Shakuna's shoulder right underneath the hood.
Right, yes.
My darling little black rat! That was gathered in the quintessential dungeon. Was also one of the reviewers.
So you don't have anything against rats in particular, just were rats.
Yes.
And of course, Isol has his lizard.
Yeah, who would probably just be like hiding while I'm riding the horse anywhere safe that can cling on to as hard as humanly possible.
That or is probably inside the room playing with the snakes.
Alright. So, does anyone have anything specific that they'd like to talk about on the way to Umbrichill, or shall I just jump to that point?
I'm good.
In character, I'd be talking with Chakunas about their adventures, but I don't see any need to roleplay through that.
Sure.
Yeah, and I'm going to stay in the front, like, just focused on getting there.
Okay. So, in the short, scant couple of hours that takes you to drive there, you arrive at Umbridge Hill. I guess this is now another... I'm on the wrong layer. Token layer. Copy, and where is Umbridge Hill? This list is too long. Let's see if I get that right. Nope.
Wow, we were very far away from the Butterskull Ranch. I was not quite...
That worked.
...quite aware how far away we were. Dang. Oh, sorry.
Question, Shadow. The Lost... What was it? The Lost Mine? No. What was it again? The Lost...
The Lost Mine of Phandelver?
Yeah.
Yes.
The Lost Mine of Phandelver. Would that have been one of the campaigns that we're going to do after this one?
No.
Okay. That's a starter campaign. You get it with the box, the starter box.
Yeah. Oh, right. They're kind of like two main entry points for 5e right now. Like, there's the starter kit, which has Lost Mine of Phandelver, or there's the D&D Essentials kit, which has Dragon of Icespire Peak, which is what we're doing.
Because I'm going to be making... Due to my move, since I'm going to be moving soon, well, not soon, it's going to take a while because of loan and generations and all that, but I want to start getting my own physical copies of dungeon guides and all that. So, I'm not going to be DMing, but I just want to have a basic concept that I have. It's going to go through stuff and some type of notes and stuff. I've got some of the D&D plans on the roll.
Nice. Okay. Yeah. So, I should have brought you over now to. The Umbridge Hill map.
Holy shiza, it's a biggie.
The moment the horse stops, I'll just fall off of it.
Okay.
Yeah. Stand up, dust myself off. I hate these. I hate everything. Okay, we're here.
Trish, is your token inside a square? Because I see it smack in the middle.
Well, yeah, it's... There we go.
Okay.
Trish, can you see if you are able to move your token for me, please?
You should right just be now, able to... I don't see my token. Wait, is this it?
So do you see the map in Roll 20 where it's kind of like
I
the...
I do see the map. I'm kay. Trying to... Okay.
So...
Okay. Sorry, that's zooming right. out.
Oh yeah, they I'm might be.
Back in, now that I know where to look.
It's on the top left corner. See, like six icons there.
Well, four.
The third one is the zoom.
Yeah, somehow I've frozen the map in place. Sorry.
No problem. Let's see. Well, we can see if you. Are able to get it working. Otherwise,
I guess
it would not be D&D without technical difficulties.
It really would not.
Well,
okay, there's my token, and I don't seem to be able to grab it.
I don't mean a jinx, but I haven't had any problem with Roll 20 whatsoever since we started this campaign.
Don't say that. Don't say it out loud.
Don't say it out loud.
Why are you doing it?
You're doomed.
There goes all the character sheets erased accidentally overnight.
Let's see here.
Or I just might kill Chakunas. Yeah. Here.
Okay.
It's just a little explosion where Chakunas' character is.
Eating the token.
Oh, someone just disappeared.
Yeah, that was you. Your token, anyways. I'm going to try re-putting it in.
I see it back on.
Okay. Right now, okay, I have...
Good. There you go!
Yep, okay.
Good stuff.
Just fix your moves is ready.
Meow. All right. So you guys arrive at Umbridge Hill, and it just seems to be quiet. And then kind of as you start approaching, all of a sudden there is a loud and then there's like black smoke starts billowing out of some of the ground floor windows of the mill.
Well, we definitely found an alchemist, that's for sure.
Indeed.
Do I hear any screaming?
There's no, like, it's not screaming, but it's kind of like a cry of alarm, and then some coughing, and then a woman stumbles out of the front door.
The front door is
here? Is she on fire or anything?
Pertinent questions.
Right?
I don't want to set the world on fire, honey. I love you too much.
Yeah, the door of the mill is around there. There's just kind of like ruined walls here, but like you can see over them. So you can see here, come out. Right to about there.
I'm halfway through casting the invisibility spell. Unsure of what to do at this point.
Goodness. Wow. Just throwing away an invisibility spell.
I don't like getting hurt. So, yeah, yep.
Goodness gracious, great balls of fire.
I'll walk right over and go, you all right?
And I come along.
I'll creep over and peering through windows. I'm curious.
She kind of coughs a bit, going, I had a bit of a mishap trying to brew a new potion that I was trying to make, and there was a rather explosive result, but I seem to be fine. Perhaps a little discolored as she starts to brush some soot off of her robes.
I offer her a drink from my water skin.
And she takes it gladly and says, thank you, and she starts gulping it down, and then wipes her mouth off with like her sleeve and then hands the water skin back to you. So, you were the ones who managed to convince the Manticore to go away, but you're new, and she points at Grace.
I'm new to this region, yes. Well met. My name is Grace of the Refreshing Breeze. You may call me Grace.
Huh? Well, nice to meet you. Anyway, what brings you back around this way, the rest of you, with her in tow?
Has the Manticore been back yet?
I've seen it off in the distance, but it's kept clear of my windmill here, so it hasn't bothered me again.
Oh, that's good. We might have a proposition for you.
A proposition? Sounds like you want me to make something for you.
Well, yes. We found instructions on how to make a certain potion, and we need a skilled alchemist to brew it for us.
Well, do you have said instructions? I could take a look at it and see if it's within my capabilities.
I believe we do. Aso.
I wanted to sneak over. Well, not sneak. I wanted to just kind of peer in through windows and then put on the crown of greed while they were talking.
Oh. yeah, sure. I will allow this.
Yeah, I just want to do a quick crown of greed pulse. I want to see what's going on.
Okay. Let me just double check on something. Okay.
I gotta use all the things, man.
You get the sensation of numerous. Hold on, let me see here again. Yeah, it's just a location. So, as you kind of like poking your head through a window with like all of this like billowing black smoke still kind of trying to come out, it's starting to taper off, but the Crown of Greed alerts you that there are some cabinets kind of along one of the walls where there seems to be a lot of magical something in those cabinets.
All right, and then I'll quickly, as I hear my name, take it off and like try to like shove it in my bag. Like, what? What's going on? Yes?
Are you still invisible?
No, I was halfway through casting. I didn't actually cast it.
Okay.
Do you have the piece of paper with all the instructions for the potion on it?
Oh, yes. I'll kind of just scoot over, and then hand it to her. And then, as I hand it to her, I'm like, "Oh, you're this is horribly dirty." And I'll cast press the digitation on her hand, so it's just that's clean. And then hand the piece of paper over.
And she like looks down at like her hand slowly like becoming clean, and then like reaches out and takes the paper. She starts reading it, and then like her brow starts to furrow, and then like she looks back up, and she like looks at Isil, she looks at Malik, and she like looks down at the paper again, looks back up at Malik.
Oh, it's not me. Oh no, it's him.
And she says,
just straight at Malik.
She says, "I recognized this." These writings. I've read this book before, but this page has been torn out. Where did you come across this? And why do you need this potion?
I thought it would be, I mean, look at what it says. It would be pretty self-explanatory. I killed a, wait, do it, I don't.
And then she just, she just kind of goes, "Ugh. Which one of you got cursed by it with lycanthropy?"
Just pointing at Malik. Please help.
What kind?
Where at?
Do you have the saliva?
Yes, and I'll give her the bottle.
Okay. I probably have some of these other ingredients. Oh, I see here there's also carrion crawler poison. I don't think I have any of that.
Yeah, no, we got that too, and I'll take out the other bottle and give it
to her. You have that too? Why? You're fortunate then. Well, so I think I can probably brew this, but I'm going to have to get you to do something for me in return.
Well, what do you need? And is it on like a 2-day time period clock, or is this like an immediate thing that we can kind of rush through?
See those cairns over there? And she points off in the direction to the kind of southeast to this area.
Mm-hmm.
So those are the remnants of a dwarven settlement that used to be here, and there are the cairns marking the graves of some dwarven warriors, and every few nights their ghosts rise up and drive me completely insane with their bickering. Can you please do something about them?
Yeah. Yes. I don't know. You can't. Can you stab already dead bodies? I guess. Sure. We'll give it a shot. Just kind of look at everyone with the yes.
Yeah. I think this. I think a lot of this might be on you, Ethel.
Why me? I don't know.
Because you're the one with all the magic. I seriously doubt that my arrows are going to be able to hurt ghosts.
Well, there is always my shock dagger. It could do some damage there.
Oh.
Right, and I'm sure the entertainer has some magic, right?
I do. I don't know anything about ghosts in particular, but I could think a while and see if I can come up with anything relevant.
Yeah, would I be able to know of any way to handle this, like, offhand?
Well, let me clarify this. In character, as a Dabra, so she actually says to you, you don't need to destroy the ghosts. Just convince them to make less of a racket, or move on, or whatever it is that they need to do.
Oh. Well, then we can certainly try talking to the ghosts. Have you talked with them yourself?
Oh, though? I've talked to them many times.
Have they? They said don't what listen they to want? Me. Did they say at all what they want?
Well, they just want to party, apparently.
That doesn't seem very dreadful, but I can see that you would not want to be kept up night after night.
But like, it's not even every night. It's just like every few nights. But on the occasions that it does happen, oh, I can never get any sleep.
How many times has... When did it start, specifically?
When did it start? What? It's... Since however long I've been here. Years.
Why didn't you move?
Well, because I'd rather put up with them than with the ruffians in town. Ugh.
No, I feel you on that. That town is horrible. Okay, sure.
Rather pleasant to me.
Why should she leave if they're the one that sucks?
Because
if you had told this to us of the last time that we assisted you with removing the manticore, you could have had some sour night's sleep by now. You told us the first time we got here.
The manticore was definitely a more pressing concern, and well, you know, for the most part, you know, a night's sleep, you know, every few days is a little price to pay for the general peace and quiet that I can have out here, as opposed to the sheer number of people that would be bothering me every 8 waking hour if I lived back in town. But if you folks are able to convince the ghosts to do less or move on or whatever it is, then I will accept that as payment for making this potion. Otherwise, it's going to cost you a very pretty penny.
So, explain to me again, what are these ghosts doing?
About every 3 or 4 nights, they rise up from their cairns, and then they just sit around, talk, and bicker, and yell, and, like, just generally be loud.
Lullagagging.
So I've walked over there, and with thaumaturgy, as loud as possible, as thaumaturgy can go, I'll just, hello, wake up, please. at the ground.
In broad daylight.
Yeah.
And then there's like a kind of like a low rumbling, and like some of like the stones on some of the cairns kind of quiver a little bit. And then you don't see anything, but you hear a voice call out. He's like, oi, lad, we're trying to sleep. You mind?
Yes, it's not very nice when it's done to you, is it?
Why are you disturbing our rest?
Why are you disturbing her rest?
We were here first!
So she's here now. I don't know. Respect the people alive a little bit, I guess.
Why should we?
Well, I'm just curious. What could you all possibly be arguing about that would keep a person up?
We're not able to move on to the halls of Moradin, so what else are we supposed to do except haunt the place where we're buried?
Well, why not?
Well, our clan had a feud with another clan, and this was the site of a battle between our two clans, and so we died dishonorable deaths, and so we're not allowed in the Halls of Moradin, okay?
I mean, that sounds like a pretty you problem, but what is it? Is it both of the clans here? Why argue?
Just a second here.
What is the name of the dwarven clan that we were at the archaeological site again?
I don't think they... Did I give a name?
I don't remember.
I don't think I gave a clan name. And yes, there are... sorry, let me do... and then, like, another voice calls out in a slightly different accent. Ah! Yeah, there be... both clan... dwarves of both clans here!
So you both died dishonor... What's going on here? What was the... Tell me the story of your people.
Well, we both wanted
I'm just
to
sitting down with and yelling at the dirt. I don't know. I'm not aiming at the graves. I'm yelling at the ground.
Well, you see, our two clans, we were both fighting over this hill because it was a well defensible spot, but we had our skirmish here, and some of us died. And now we're here.
So what was dishonorable?
Might have been our tactics in battle.
And what did you do? Or is this just Isil here? And we hear him yelling at the ground.
No, you can hear the dwarf voices as well.
Okay. I would love it to just be me screaming at the ground. Super loud, booming voice.
Was there a question there?
Yeah, my question was, what were the tactics?
Well, we... We gave them cursed items, says the one voice. And then the other voice responds back with, aye, and well, I suppose me and me brothers might have used some dirty fighting and struck them in some not so nice places.
That's pretty rude.
But as far as we know, that shouldn't have, you know, disallowed us from being let into Moradin's halls, but well, we're not allowed into Moradin's halls, so we're here.
I'm gonna take out the crown and pulse it because of the cursed items biz.
There doesn't seem to be anything in the area.
So, yeah, I don't see any cursed items. I think... Are you guys hiding something from me? That's not nice.
You know what? We're not going to talk to you anymore.
I'll stand up, turn around. Yeah, so they're all pretty rude. I kind of get it now. Forgetting that I still have thaumaturgy on and just walk back to the group.
My ears have been laid flat all this time.
That's fair.
Yeah, it's pretty agonizing to listen to dwarves, is it not?
I mean, they seem to be, I don't know, stuck here for some silly reason. I mean, I can't imagine that kicking someone where the sun doesn't shine to be a reason to keep you out of eternal peace, but I don't know how the dwarven religion works, so sure. And I'll sit down and start reading next to the fence.
Okay. All right.
I'll turn to Grace and say, you know any songs about the halls of Moradin?
No. Well, yes, but none that are relevant here. I suppose it would be sacrilegious to simply try breaking the cairns and see if that would dispel the ghosts.
I don't think it would make them happy, that's for sure.
Well, if they all killed each other, who built the cairns? Perhaps there are some survivors somewhere that we could ask more about this curse. But that would be an unknown journey to that would take an unknown time.
There are always those at the Mountain Gold Toll Mine, and there were those at the archaeological dig at the temple, but I do not see what they could do to Hespas. I only would believe that we could possibly camp here for the evening and wait till they come out.
Issa will look up from his book after the whole, after Grace's suggestion.
Mm-hmm.
Like, remember, it's like he forgot something. He'll walk over back to the graves and then cast suggestion and just say, could you guys just leave? 100% it won't work as a player, but Issa would totally do this. So.
Okay. Oh, 1 second here then, please.
That would be a persuasion check, wouldn't it?
Suggestion.
No, I think it'd be a...
It says you can see, but Easel's casting it at the ground, so if it does nothing, totally gonna roll with that.
Wisdom saving throws, eh?
Mm-hmm.
Ah. Well, there's always a chance for inspirations. 14. Or not.
There's nothing. I don't roll here. And it only lasts for 8 hours, so it's not like it's even permanent.
So they could leave and come back.
Yeah.
We fix your problem.
Did it. 100% done. That's the easy way.
Oof.
This whole session now is beginning to think that Issel is evolving from a warlock into a thief into a fighter.
I'm a man of many talents.
Multiplistic warlock, I don't know.
Except I can't get hit because I made it out of paper mache.
So 6, 4, 9, 4, 3, 7.
No way.
Did they all fail?
Yep.
Okay. All
right. Wait, what's your spell cast DC?
14.
14?
Yeah, it's 14. We're level 4. It's not that big.
I'm gonna let this happen.
Yeah, awesome.
Because this is funny.
My question is, will it be a temporary effect or no?
Who cares?
Oh, it's kind of fraudulent. It's only temporary.
Oh, welcome to the Shadow Crew.
Yeah, nothing else as it seems here.
Mm-hmm.
I'm not Jakunas, really. I'm Malik.
And like all of a sudden, like the voices, like the dwarven voices, are all kind of like whispering amongst each other, and then the one that had first kind of called out to you then says, like, we're gonna leave. I guess we can actually go to Clan Giddens' table. That seems like a thing, right? And then like they all sounds just kind of like whisper again. And then, like, you can actually feel, like, this kind of, like, weird, like, cold. It's almost as if, like, a cold sensation left, or like there's a sudden rush of warmth in the area.
I will stand up and just like did it again. Save the day. Look at this guy go. And I'll start taking the stone things down and like disassembling them.
Okay.
Yeah. So they can't come back, right? That's how that's gonna work. I don't know.
So did you get them to leave?
I know, right? I don't know what's happening. My guiding bolts have been working, and this just happened. I'm having a great couple of days.
Well done.
Well done indeed.
And then Adabra walks up to Malak and says, "So you were the one afflicted with lycanthropy, right?"
Yes.
I've read the book that this is from.
Really?
Most other alchemists and apothecaries dismiss the writings of the person who wrote this. This does seem like it might do something. Uh-oh. If it's a true cure, I'm not entirely sure.
It might do something.
Oh, no. Boy.
Oh, yikes. That is a dangerous dice to roll.
It will take me at least overnight tonight to successfully brew the potion and let it settle.
I don't have a problem with it.
Okay.
And something's better than nothing.
I don't really have much room in the windmill to offer you, but you feel free to make camp in the ruins of the house part here.
Oh yeah, that's fine. We'll stay out here. That's not a problem.
Well, then okay. There's always the dwarves to take care of after 8 hours, so...
Well, I will try making this potion then, and then I will report back to you once I've discovered anything further, I suppose.
It sounds good. Thank you, Adabra.
And then she, like, goes back off into the windmill, and then you can hear her rattling around, collecting different stuff, and, like, firing up a fire to, like, start boiling things.
I'll play a song and give her bardic inspiration for her ability check.
Ooh, okay.
For the remainder of the time that we are here, I am just slow, like very daintily, trying to get myself as minimal dirty as possible. I will be deconstructing all of the grave sites.
Okay.
And I'll do it all through the night too. Like, it will take me hours of just slowly moving these rocks, but I will not stop until it's all done.
We're gonna be here overnight. Shakunis, I do believe I said that I owe you some venison, right?
Yes, I believe you said you did.
Yeah, well, I'm gonna go see if I can scare one up around here somewhere.
Oh, but you're coming straight out of were rats. It should be no problem for you.
Hey, very funny. You want to stay here or you want to come with me?
No, I have had enough of combat to do, so I will remain here with Diesel and Adabra.
All right, then.
And Grace, of course.
And I will walk back over to the horses and hop on and take a ride to go see if I can find some deer.
Okay. Make a survival check at advantage for me then, please.
Survival check. 21.
So you are able to successfully track down and slay 2 deer and take all of the meat that you can basically carry from them.
Nice.
And that will take you a few hours. So the rest of you are able to just kind of chill out around here if there's anything that you wish to discuss or do.
I'm just slowly moving rocks, man.
Okay.
I am fascinatedly watching the little book, the little scholar move these rocks around and wondering what on earth has gotten into him.
I'm placing them all in like a weird grid, almost all equidistant apart. Each individual rock. I'm being very methodical about it. Really measuring where, like, the size of the rock and where it should go in, you know, relation to the other rocks. We're really breaking it down. Take a like a good minute pause between moving each rock as well.
Eventually, as you come down to like near the bottom of the stone piles, you do find the well desiccated, like basically skeletons of these dwarven warriors. Anything that seems to have maybe been like buried alongside them seems to have basically corroded or like disintegrated away, and it's basically just their skeletons left.
Do I know of the ritual rites of like dealing with the dead for dwarves?
Make a religion check for me.
Sure. Do religion. Oh. Of course I don't have anything there. Great.
Yes, you are at least somewhat familiar with it, and you know that in this kind of environment that cairns are definitely the preferred method of burial for the dwarvish dead, since they were not in an area that was like more of a like a mountain with actual tombs.
But they'd rather be in a tomb in a mountain than like here on yes. the top of a hill. Okay. Yeah. So I'll spend like, I mean, I can go the entire night because I don't need to sleep, slowly like wrapping bones up and in like a piece of cloth and trying to get like bundles, to be moved. Cause I'm sure we're going to go near a mountain at some point that I can drop these guys off at.
Okay.
Once I finally see what he's doing and that he's trying to be sort of respectful, I will go help him.
Okay.
It's always a hard call with Easel. I get it.
Eventually, around shortly after sunset, Malik will return with his venison. Shakunis, was there anything that you wish to have been doing during this time?
I think Shakunis might be MIA currently.
Oh. I see. Wonder what happened there.
I don't think I have. Nope, I can't make any type of magical fire, so I won't. I will not stop what I'm doing.
I was busy looking at D&D stuff and wasn't looking at the camps.
Well, I have survival skill. I can light a fire to help cook the deer if that's what you're after.
Okay. So, Malik, shall we say that you are back now, then?
Yep.
Okay. So you're kind of like, what do you wish to do with the venison that you have brought back?
Oh, I'm going to light a fire. I'm going to
You are?
Unless there was already one lit, I'm going to start preparing it.
Okay. All right. So we'll move then into everyone just kind of sitting around a fire. In the kind of this area, then? Is that suitable?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Okay. So as you're kind of sitting around cooking the venison and just making idle chatter, Adabra comes back out and she has a stern look on her face. She points at Malik and she says, "I need to talk to you."
All right then. And I'll get up and go over here.
Okay. And she says, "I don't know if you want your companions to hear this or not, but I have concerns about the efficacy of this proposed cure."
Really?
From what I'm able to surmise, this will at least be able to suppress any physical changes to you, but the curse may well remain active since it is magical in nature. The effects of the potion may only last for, and my best estimate, 7 weeks. Now, your best hope is then to take the potion, and then within that 7 weeks, find a magical means of actually lifting the curse.
Like a powerful cleric.
Yes. The effects of the potion will suppress any kind of, like, physical changes or urges, but you will need the assistance of this powerful cleric or someone who is able to remove curses to truly remove the curse.
Well, you said it was something, and I said something was better than nothing, right?
Yep, that is what we said.
Alright, I believe I could probably find a cleric in the next 7 weeks.
Well, then that would be fortunate for you.
Do you have any suggestions? Do you know of any clerics?
That is a good question. My best advice... Where the heck is... Sorry, just give me 1 minute here.
Adabra searches through her memory. She has lived many years.
All right, she says, "I wonder if there would be anyone left from the shrine of Savris near Coneyberry who might be able to help you. I did hear tell that it may have been abandoned of late, but that's the only center of the clerical type in the relatively near area that I am aware of, without having to go all the way over to the coast to Neverwinter."
Right, well, yeah. I guess I can try there. We're going to be in the area anyway.
Well, that doesn't surprise me, considering your little group of adventurers. The potion is still brewing. It should be ready in a few more hours yet, probably near dawn.
Alright. Thank you, Adabra. I really appreciate it. And I know you wanted us to get rid of the ghosts and all that, but I want you to have this, and I'm going to take out 50 gold and give it to her.
She, like, takes it, weighs it in her hand, kind of, like, looks as if she thinks for a moment, and then she just nods and says, "Thank you," and then, like, turns around and heads back inside.
And I'm going to turn around and head back to the camp.
Okay.
And so Shakuna sits by the fire and looks up at the manacle. "Well, what did you have to say?"
Shakunis, did I ever show you this pouch that I have? And I'm gonna pull my cloak aside, and I get a little black and red pouch right on the side. Just little like this. I'm gonna open it up. I'm gonna take out a bottle of spices. I'll put it down. I'm gonna take out another bottle of spices, put it down, and another bottle of spices, and put it down, and another bottle of spices. And I'm gonna take out like maybe 25 bottles of spices out of this tiny, tiny, tiny little pot.
I assume this is for the curse.
No, this is for the venison.
Like, what, 25 tiny vials of something for the venison you are preparing to cook for us, for me?
Well, no. I'm not going to use them all. I know Isil's seen this before, because I've cooked for him before, right? Before we met. I got this quite a few years ago, right?
So just listen and tell me.
So yes. this little pouch that I have, right? I got it quite a few years ago from a pirate. Right. It was a parting gift. Now, you've heard of a bag of holding, right?
I have heard of some. Yes.
Well, this is a tiny little version of that. And the only thing it holds is these spices, right? And now this is called this belonged to a thief, right? Apparently his name was Hotch or something. This is called Hotch's Helpful Haversack, right? Now I know it's not haversack size, but I think they called it that just for the alliteration, right? Now, I'm gonna take some of these spices, I'm gonna put it on the venison, right? And then I want you to try it. And I want you to tell me what you think. And then I'm gonna start spicing up the meat.
Yes, I presume that meat is on some sort of stick and like...
Oh yeah, sure, yeah. There's like a little thing, yeah. Oh yeah, okay. No, I have all kinds of cooking shit.
Yeah.
Of course you do, Mr. Wood Elf, Maestro of the Chef. There's a Gordon Ramsay of the Wood Elves. Oh, Lord above. So Sukunos just takes off a fork and just takes a bite if he has cut it up or whatever. And he just eats it and go. Is it hard? What's the effect? What's the spice effect?
Who are you asking, me?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Oh, there's all right. So there's a little bit of onion, right? A little bit of garlic, some oregano.
Garlic.
I don't think you're a vampire, Shikunis.
Found about.
But I am a dragon, so you never know.
Well, a complicated Malik backstory where he feeds everyone garlic to make sure.
But yeah, onion, garlic, and...
Onion, garlic, oregano, a little bit of chili.
So it's
a little black pepper.
It certainly has a flair. I would say I could certainly taste the chili, and is it a pinch of salt?
Oh yeah.
Some form of garlic. Well, it tastes good. It That's good. I assume you prepared the same for Isak when he first, when you sent him those years ago.
Now, Isak has a very bland taste.
Well, of course, it would be as an Asimov.
Isak gets, he doesn't like anything distracting him while he's reading, so it can't be too spicy.
I told you it would be good.
You did indeed. I must compliment you. It has been a while. I have tasted fine meats, fine spicy meats.
Oh, thank you.
And I certainly will believe that we shall have some for quite a while. You have, from what you gathered, we have enough for several days.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, I found two nice bucks. I got this right that I'm cooking right now, and then I wrapped the rest out of some paper that I can...
Well, certainly meat is on the menu for the next several weeks, after all. We have the bacon at the inn as well to prepare.
No, I think we picked up the bacon.
Yeah, I think he's been eating the bacon.
Yeah, we picked up the bacon. Yeah, because I remember I kept offering you pocket bacon.
Oh, yeah. I just kept thinking back to the first part when you just paid with all the servers. Okay, ah, when you had to pay for all the bacon. I just kept thinking massive amounts of bacon. Oh, all right.
Then I'll look at Grace and go, "What about you, Tabaxi? You want some of the? You want to try some of this?"
Yes, certainly. I'll try it.
All right.
Shuckling his hands, the fork over to Grace. Or should I say, Grace?
Thank you. Yes, I hand you back the fork and get my own implements out and cut off some meat for myself. And this is quite good for camping food, camping game food. Thank you. And I, eat my fill.
I used to be a cook.
Did you? I'm not surprised to hear it.
He says used to, but he still is.
I assume you mean you used to be a professional cook?
I used to work as a cook, yeah.
Ah.
A couple of inns, a ship for a while.
It almost sounds like you have lived a human's life. I cannot see a wood elf of your ethnicity to have been around and serving on, say, on ships and inns. I would imagine that you being a ranger to have one of the wilds of them, more than you have served within small rooms and sliced up beef and cut the vegetables for a living.
Oh no, I've traveled all across Faerûn.
I could see the appeal. After all, one cannot just cross the ocean by walking on it, unless you would have many bottles of water walking potions.
At this point, a plate just floats across by Mage Hand. Isil's reading, and a plate just comes out and stops in front of the meat.
I'll slice off a piece without even looking. I'll just slice off a piece and put it on there.
It'll float back to me as I read. Just hovers there. I do not touch it for a while.
Yeah, well, I never crossed an ocean, but I spent some time on the Sea of Fallen Stars. That was the ship that I worked on.
And while Grace is tasting the meat, she kind of looks towards her and goes, "I do not believe I have seen your kind before. Well, Tabaxi, is it? Well, where are you upon the continent of Faerûn?"
"Sir Kunis, you've never met a Tabaxi before."
"I may have met something similar, but they were quite hostile
So you've never been on a ship. You've never been met a tabaxi. I think you need to be the one that travels around Faerûn.
I perhaps a little wonder.
I think you've spent too much time in the Underdark.
Well, it was not by choice at the first, but as time passed, I was kept down further and further till, let us say, some arrangements were made, and I traveled upwards to the overworld, as to so to say. Even visited one particular inn which had some very strange rumors surrounding it. But I have not met this tabaxi kin before. I did not mean disrespect towards you or your kin, but I am one to venture far from the possibility of coin. For I have much down below, but I have little up on the overworld.
Well, I would certainly be interested to hear more about that at some point, if you are willing to tell some tales. But to answer your question, it's not too surprising that you haven't met Tabaxi before. Our people are not actually from this continent. We're from Mastakan. My parents are travelers here. And there aren't many that come all this way across the wide seas but that's part of why I'm traveling around and getting to know the land. I've heard many stories when I was studying at the College of Lore of Fukluklin, but there's a great difference in seeing things for yourself.
I can relate. And I would gladly to know further once we have slain this dragon and helped this filthy hill folks of the Fandolin.
Filthy?
Is that Isil rubbing off on you? Is that what that was?
No, it's more like. It doesn't trust the Fandolin folks very much. I mean, they're probably just a humble folk, but the townsmen and the alchemists, it seems like the town is more trouble than it's worth.
Everyone has seemed a little brusque, to be sure.
Yeah.
Odd to hear that, since they've been so pleasant and kind to me.
Well, I will not offend, but you may have perhaps some of the feline charm towards them. And while so Shakira's Sunio just posed and go, and she goes, "Oh, you want some little venison, my little furry friend? Malak, could you cut a very tiny small piece for my good rat here?"
I'll cut up a little piece for him.
And it takes it to go there. Ah, senor, do you approve? And you go. And you go. Would there be a chance you could cut up several tiny small pieces and lay it in some pouch if there's a chance? I do believe Sudio could. Perhaps Isos Discipline would want some as well.
You know what I can do is I'll cut up a bunch of little pieces, right? I'll take some of the juice from the other cuts that I have, right? And I'll put that in there. So it'll be like like half liquidy and half solid. I think he really, really will like that. It's like little chunks.
Half fat and half solid meat.
Yeah.
And Signor just eagerly just wants more because the taste of the chili, the salt, and the onion and all that, it just made him a little giddy and eager for excitement. Well, I certainly appreciate the food, the venison. It's most delicious. I am not one to know much of cooking, for I've always dined at the inn, at the finest inns available, and drank white wine, but have you considered the possibility of mixing some with the bacon?
Oh yeah, absolutely. Yeah, would you like a piece with the bacon on it? Because I'll put bacon on anything.
Why did I have a feeling that of course you would put bacon on anything? It is you, after all. But no. It is a mere thought. I'm actually enjoying the venison as it is. Thank you.
Oh, we just got raided.
Oh,
who raided?
Welcome, raiders.
Hey, thank you.
Yep.
Oh, welcome, Tales raiders. From the Grim. Oh, good lord. Grim Tales. Mm-hmm.
Thank you. Raiders. Yeah. Thank you, Tales from the Grim. You may notice that Arv is actually not here tonight. Or, well, he was in chat earlier, but he's not streaming. I am, of course, Shadowed Mage, and this is the Shadow Crew, and we're doing some community D&D on Arv's channel, playing Dragon of Icespire Peak. This is episode 9, I believe we're on. Yep.
Yes.
Which, my original title that I was going to give to Arv was... what did I say that was?
The Claws of Curiosity.
That was the part that he had to cut off. So,
next time I'll just say DM. Well, Shadow Mage D&D something.
Yeah, it's A Curse's Conceivable Cure? ? And then the second part of the title was going to be and the Claws of Curiosity, because we were lucky enough to add in Trish down at the bottom of the webcam arrangement there into our group tonight, who is playing a Tabaxi lore bard.
Which is a feral race, people.
And of course, you can find all of our group's information by doing Shadow Crew! !Shadow Crew! And !ShadowCars! In chat. So, yeah. Thank you, raiders. Welcome in, everyone.
And if you're wondering who the channel belongs to, it is Arvin Elrond, who is a professor at a university and is a podcaster, and he has his own band, and he does D&D mostly on this channel, which this week has begun with us, the Shadow Crew, as it is the July 1st. And if you want to know more about Arvin Edelman's thing, just check out the links in chat. And beyond that, welcome to episode 9 of Shadow Crew D&D. And please wish Twitch Ambassador a very, very big welcome. She has been with the channel for about a few several months now, I believe. And yeah, beyond that, we're just sitting around the campfire talking crap.
Right. You've missed a fascinating discussion about cooking venison with various spices and maybe
a very adorable black rat on my shoulder of a drow elf eating munching on venison.
Yeah. All right. So that was actually some really good role play amongst yourselves there for a good while.
Yes, well, I can do many voices if you like. I can have some intruders coming along if you want as well.
So, or I can have some bloody gnomes or have some fucking I can do British at once.
I will I'll perhaps bring things along, though, and have us skip to the morning after everyone's rested. And
suddenly he was become aware that Malak is no more, he said.
And actually, yes, in fact, I do need Malak to do a wisdom saving throw.
I will play a song and inspire him beforehand.
Ah, sure.
Nice. Wisdom saving throw. All right, here we go.
Bardic inspiration.
Oh, shit.
1d6.
Oh, yeah. No. Bro.
Ooh.
So that would be... Oh, wait. How does Bardic inspiration work? It's just inspiration,
1d6
right?
Before you know whether it succeeds or fails.
So yeah,
DC 13.
No, you can know your die roll. It's just you have to add the inspiration before he says whether it succeeds or fails.
Yes. Oh, so now I would roll. So now yes. I would roll 1d6.
And you have inspiration on the character sheet as well. So just click that. I think.
Well, the Bardic inspiration is different. It's the 1d6 added in instead of regular inspiration. Just gives advantage.
Right.
So add in the 1d6. So
5 plus 3 is 8.
All right.
Oh no.
Vierats.
Malik, you notice that you're already slightly long and pointed elvish ears now have some tufts of fur growing out along the edges of them.
Yeah, I'm just gonna put up my hood.
Also, you can feel your feet kind of like strain against your boots as your toes have tried to grow claws.
This is uncomfortable.
Is the horse scared of him now?
No, the horses are fine.
Okay, good.
Adabra comes out and she says, "Potion should be finished."
Oh, just in the nick of time.
You ready to try it?
Absolutely.
All right, well, come with me.
And I'll...
Good thoughts, everybody. Good thoughts.
All right.
I'll like put a hand on his shoulder as he goes, still reading, and just some guidance.
Okay. All right. So you follow Adabra in to the main floor of the windmill, and she leads you over to a vial on a countertop that it has this kind of swirling green and blue quality to it, and she says, "I've just finally concentrated it all, poured it into this vial. It's ready to be taken, so good luck."
I'll pick it up and look at it and go, "Oh, that's quite pretty, actually."
"Well, I think that's mostly down to the carrion crawler poison."
Well, I'll pop the top off of it and drink it.
All right. Give me a constitution saving throw.
You can inspire people if you want to help save,
You get a d4 on that too.
Save, Malak here. Because this is the roll that's going to determine the effect, alright? Isn't it? Shout out?
I want to see what he gets, and then I'll describe what happens. So an 11.
So an 11.
All right. So, as you start to consume the potion, you notice that it has a very kind of bitter taste to it. You kind of sputter a bit, almost to the point of coughing some of it back up. But you actually do manage to take all of it down and drink it down to the last drop. And once you've done so, you feel a sensation kind of spread out from your stomach out into the extremities of your body. And then eventually, as you feel it get down into your feet and your ears, you feel the claws from your feet start to retract and the hair on your ears start to disappear. And you feel completely normal.
For the next 7 weeks.
Yeah.
I'll pull my hood back down. Yeah. I think that worked, Adabra. Thank you.
And she sighs a sigh of relief. And she's like, oh, I'll confess, I was might worried, even though I was fairly confident in my assessment of how it would work. But you are welcome. Just make sure to take care of that dragon that's been plaguing the area, will ya?
Yeah, it's on our to-do list.
Yeah, I thought as much. I overheard some of your conversation. I heard that you lost that other member to the dragon, so that is always hard to lose a friend.
Yes, it was, it took us quite a surprise.
Well, perhaps that new, tabaxi will help you out in your travels.
Oh, I hope so.
Now, I'd kindly like it if you all would leave and leave me to it.
Oh, yes. Yes, absolutely. Yeah.
Great.
And I'll pat her on the shoulder and I'll say, we'll go.
Thank you again, Adabra.
And I'll walk back to these guys.
Right then, everything's all right. We should probably go now, because, you know, she doesn't like to be bothered. And she helped us out, so, you know.
Fair enough. So you are cured now?
Not exactly, but I'm better than I was. So, there's that.
Good.
So this cure is not permanent, or it is what?
No, it's not permanent. I'm going to have to find a powerful cleric that can remove the curse. But I am fine for probably about 2 months.
Issa will visibly wince when you say powerful cleric. No, it's fine. We don't. You'll be... It... Oh, gross. Where do we have to go?
Well, I think right now we should just get right back to what we were doing before. You know, the to-do list.
Oh, right. What was the next one on the list? And I'll pull out, like, all of the quest papers again and start rifling through them. Oh, we had Butterskull Ranch next, I believe, is... Yes? Money?
Right.
Butter Skull? What an odd name.
Yeah, indeed. I don't know who names these, but they certainly are not intelligent.
No, they're not good at naming things at all.
Yeah. Well, I guess it is money, so I will go there. So, yeah, I'll just put them all back away.
And what was... There was another one over by Conniberry.
Yes.
Butter Skull is the one by... When he buried.
Oh, it is?
Yeah.
Oh, okay. All right. Never mind.
Right.
And
yeah,
what is your task at Butter Skull?
Oh, right. And I'll pull him back out again. Rifle through it. Urgent. Well, we definitely haven't hurried there. Maybe we should go before we talk about. Oh, no. Maybe the next one? Yeah? And I'll flip to that one. Oh, okay. I have them here somewhere.
Just for reference, Butterskull Ranch is... orcs have attacked Butterskull Ranch, 5 miles east of Conniberry along the Tribor Trail. Travel there with haste, assess the damage, and help any way you can. The ranch owner, Alphonse Big Al Calazorn, is a retired sheriff who can reward you for your efforts. However, if he's dead, return to Townmaster Harbin Wester with proof of Calazorn's demise to receive a reward of 100 gold. I just realized, I'm not sure, do you have these in your journal, Trish? Or do I need to...
Yeah, I'll just recite it out loud to the group.
I do, yes.
Okay.
Are
all four there, or is just the one that I just put
there out? Are four. Right. Okay. I have four.
Okay, good.
I should see Mountain, Butterskull, Loggers, and Axel.
Yep.
Well, yes.
Actually, I guess I can remove Mountain's Toe now. Since you guys are done with that one.
Yeah, we're not going back there.
All right.
Well, you said that one's urgent.
Mm. Yes. It says haste, which we have certainly not made.
Right, yeah. No, not at all. Well, what do you say we head there now?
I mean, good news. We can still collect a reward even if they are dead.
Right.
So, yay! Huh.
Oh, the mob tuber of a warlock.
I'll grab like the delicately wrapped bone piles and attach them to the saddlebags on the horse.
Yep.
Okay, I will help since it doesn't look like Izzel is great with pack saddles either.
Nope. Okay. I'm like doing like just a one tie knot and then patting it, and then it starts to slouch a little bit. Oh no.
I will assist.
Shakuna just stands by the horse because it's all packed up and ready to go by the time this morning.
It's not that I'm helping Ezel so much as that I'm trying to make sure these remains are treated respectfully, not falling off and rolling on the ground.
Ezel's certainly trying his best. He's just not good.
Right.
Well, I think with you guys then heading out, it is about, we've been going for about 2 hours and a half to 2 hours 40 minutes, so this might be a good place to maybe call it for tonight, if everyone is amenable to that.
Yeah,
I'm okay with that.
Okay. Yep.
I'm okay.
All right, well, that was, pretty good. No fights or anything, but lots of good character moments. A great introduction to I can't roll my R's to Grace.
That's fine.
Grace.
Thank you, Echo.
Thank you.
So we will actually
Grace.
Yeah. So we will actually start down at the bottom with our new member, Trish. Trish, what did you think of tonight? Did you have a good time, though? How do you see Grace getting along with the others? And anything else you might like to add?
And what do you think? Well, what is your assessment of the chemic between, like, what is it called? The chemistry between the chemistry between us as players.
I did have fun tonight, thank you. I enjoyed the role playing and the, you know, give and take. I've been enjoying the humor in the community D&D campaign, and so it's fun to join in on that. No doubt we'll have more dramatic times, you know, next time or the next.
I'm sure of that.
Yes. But it was fun. I had a good time. I don't think Grace is quite gelling with the party yet. She's more just tagging along, but you know, it seems quite possible that, you know, she will develop closer ties with these people. I thought it was a good night.
Yeah, good stuff. Any stuff online about yourself that you'd like to plug?
Sure. My first solo narration on LibriVox came out last Sunday.
Oh, very nice.
I read H. Beam Piper's Omnilingual, novelette. And
if you have a link, just post it in chat.
Sure, I will do that.
If you like. You don't have to. Because...
Yeah, just a minute. But you can also find a link to that on my occasional blog, which I've started, you know, it was fallow for about 2 years, but I've started doing stuff again this summer at whatsthewordnow.blogspot.com. But I'll put a link in the chat to the novelette on LibriVox.
Okay.
Well,
I'll do that once I finish talking. I'm also on several podcasts, Supergirl and occasionally SFF Audio and the Hugo nominated Skippy and Fancy show.
All right, well, I'll actually have to get some of your social media stuff to add into our Shadow Crew command to update that. Make sure that that's up to date. Other than that, we'll go up the line to Echo.
Yeah, it was a fun session. I won't say I had a problem speaking proper English, but then I was too, because being on live stream and seeing myself on live, it's still hard getting used to. I don't know. But fun session. I've been enjoying the whole thing, but I don't know. I feel like the evolution of Shakunas is going at a slow pace. I don't know. I mean, I don't want to say much, but I've been contemplating of possibly changing character. I don't know. I will discuss this with Shadow then so forth. Because doing the Russian accent is it's been more trouble than it's worth. So I don't know. I might change characters. Maybe.
Well, or otherwise, we can discuss some options.
Yeah.
Even if it's just... Anyway.
But beyond that, you can find me on Twitch and Twitter at @echoalpha_x5. I don't do much. I just auto-host many great streamers, and I tweet a lot. Well, I don't tweet, but I retweet a lot of stuff other people have tweeted, because I find it very positive and very... positivity and all that. And I am soon going to be moving to a new apartment, which is going to be owned by my brother. So it's going to be me and him. And he is also a D&D lover. And it won't afflict the cast because we have already got the internet installed already. So it will be a swift transition. And beyond that, I'm still waiting for some like 10 books. After some of the Archon and the Icarus library, the Icarus Jellic novels and the library, so I'm looking forward to that. And I'm waiting also on my Infinity and Beyond premium tea that I bought recently. So, and we should really soon have an intro video for us made by Cruel Wolf, because I am a fully endorsed person of Cruel Wolf. He is an amazing VFX artist, he's an amazing musician, and yeah. And we need to pump some. We need to get the party started more. But yeah, I'm gonna be passing on up to that freak of a fighter, warlock, thief, cleric, something. I don't know, Medusa, Asimar, all of the above, whatever it is. So yeah, up to you,
Hoodie,
Mr. NQH, something. I don't know what now.
I always have fun with character stuff. I'm really curious, because Esil isn't a warm person, how Esil is going to handle a new person being around, because I haven't gotten to explore that. We haven't gotten to see it. And Esil is a very standoffish type character. So I've been having fun trying to not go, because I'm curious. I have questions. I've been trying to not go too hard to the paint with that and instead just play Esil the way that Esil would want to, like, slowly warm up to. It's fun. I enjoy that stuff so much. I love character progression. I'm looking forward to even more sessions, because then you get to crack that egg, and it'll be fun. I'm here. I'm on NoCorder_TV. That's where I stream. That's it. I had fun. It was great. I'm gonna pass it on up.
Yeah. All right. Thank you. Rock good.
Yeah, we're all kind of standoffish.
Yeah, that's not a warm group at all.
I have my moments.
Yeah, because I mean, Malik kind of just sees Grace as like a, you know, like a tag along at this point, you know.
Well, she is a feline character, so.
Notice, Malik has not called Grace by her name.
Yeah, neither has Cecil.
He called her entertainer, and he called her tabaxi, and that was it. And
Onish Kunos is called her Grace, actually.
Yeah.
And I'm also interested in finding out why Shakunis is a big deal in the Underdark, but not so much up top side. That was a nice little, that was like a one line little hint at a backstory.
Yeah, it's very nice.
And I was like, ooh, that piqued my interest.
I've been pondering a lot about the background story of Shakunis, but it's going to take a lot of research to do that, and depending on if I'm going to keep the character or not, depending, because it has been a lot of fun, but the trouble is to maintain the accent and all that. It's just, it's too much trouble for me.
You'd always get a concussion and change accents. There you go.
Yeah. Exactly.
It wouldn't be hard to.
We can reincarnate you. That's a spell in the D&D world. Just bring you back as a new race, new accent.
Well, right. There's that. So.
So many options.
But I don't know. I feel. I always think about I hate to plug another campaign, but I'm going to have to just say I would think back on Ryu Darkrash from Jesus Arthur Robb's character on the Rise of Tiamat. Because he was sent to actually be a spy or something, I believe. Then he turned on them and became friends with the whole group, and he rebelled against the Underdark.
Hmm.
So, I don't know. I feel a sort of sense that the Underdark are sort of a drow elf with a sense of high class society, while they have still their own little beggars, well, like a sort of beggar's nests and still separated. You know, like Snowpiercer, you have the train for the lower class and then you have the upper class, etc., etc., etc. So, I don't know, but yeah. I can see that why that little line has been like, ooh, I mean, I'm more interested in Shakura's background now.
See?
Yep.
Yeah.
But yeah, other than that, you can find me here in the chat. I did have a good time tonight. I liked it. Welcome, Trish, by the way.
Thanks.
Yes, welcome.
Very much welcome.
Yeah,
it's very exciting to have a new dynamic in the group.
Yes. Thank you for joining our motley crew.
A very, very standoffish characters.
Right, yeah.
Very brave move.
But like I said, you can find me in the chat. You can find me here. You can find me at my Instagram, mdrewzion. Yes. I haven't
posted. Check it out. It's amazing.
I haven't posted much because I haven't been out much because of the stupid fucking virus. But I don't know. You can go look at my old pitches. It's all good.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Well, thank you, everyone, for a good session of D&D. Good evening. And this will now be our sign-off. Make sure to follow Arv on all of the things.
Exclamation mark our things, exclamation mark our shop, exclamation mark Shadow Group for information about us, exclamation mark Shadow Cars, CHARS for information about our characters, and more information will come about Trisha Matz, her social media and stuff. And she has also posted a link for her first solo project on LibriVox, narration of HBeam something something, I just lost it now. on H.P. Piper's 1957 novelette, Omnilingual.
Yes.
All right.
God, man, that's a lot of English to say. But yeah, all the information is in chat. Well, pardon me, but something is amiss. There we go. So yeah, all the information in chat. And please do give a big round of applause for our DM, Shadow Mage, because he had... I want to say he had it already, but he fumbled a little bit tonight, perhaps, because we were barely able to just... He had to be reminded for one final thing, otherwise it's going to be just pear-shaped. But yeah, it's all good. We all had a fun session, and welcome to the match of the crew. And Shadow, would you want to say something before we sign off?
Not really. Just make sure you go follow all of us who have interesting social media stuff. Go follow Trish's stuff. Go follow Hoodie's stuff. Go follow Rock God on Instagram. Echo and I guess, have Twitter accounts. That's kind of...
Yep.
Other than that, catch us again in 2 weeks for the 15th. Our next session.
Mm-hmm.
We'll maybe see if the characters will maybe open up and become a little more friendly with each other. Who knows?
Spoilers. Isil did hear the word college, so that conversation is coming. But he's sitting on it until he can trust.
Right. Okay.
Okay.
But
something to look forward to.
Okay.
So, not sure you want to look forward to.
Something to anticipate.
Yeah, there it is.
There we go.
I'm so sorry.
Thank you, everyone. Thank you to all of our viewers. Thank you to chat.
All be well. Take good care. Stay safe. Stay indoors. Stay the fuck at home.
Stay healthy.
Stay healthy. And again, just be yourselves. And Pride Month is over, but still don't stop. Just celebrate who you are. Black Lives Matter! BLM and chat. Don't forget about that. Human Lives Matter. Planet Lives Matter. Everything matters. And November 2020, we can hope the day comes that we can kick the Trump butt out of office.
Mm.
And since it is the 1st of July, happy Digital Independence Day to everybody in America. So, upcoming.
Today was Canada Day.
It's Canada Day.
Right? Happy Canada Day.
Yeah. Happy Canada Day.
It is Canada Day.
That was me.
Happy Shadow next. Canada Day.
Yeah, and then July 4th will be the USA Independence Day. So
the ID Day.
All right. Well, thank you, Echo, for all of that help with wrapping things up. And now we will cut to outro.
See you guys later.
Bye.
Good night.
Thanks, everybody.